comes the, here comes the, here comes the.
Y'all don't really want it like that.
Yeah. Here comes the.
So I keep big bills up in my heart on the dirty like blood. So ain't got no twist in my head, but I'm still dreadful. And I got plenty of bread, so I go to bed full. I'm in it to win it, to win it, I'm all in, I might.
The triple jump is one of the more complicated and challenging events in track and field competitions. The goal of a triple jumper is to attain the greatest possible horizontal distance. The distance covered depends largely on the horizontal approach speed and the extent to which this can be controlled, conserved, and evenly distributed over the three phases, the hop, the step, and the jump phase.
The hop starts with the athlete jumping from a takeoff mark on one leg using the speed gained from the approach run and ends by landing on the runway with the same leg. In this step, the athlete immediately jumps with the takeoff leg and lands on the runway with the opposite leg. This is followed by the jump, where the athlete jumps from that same non-takeoff leg and brings the opposite leg to land in a sand-filled pit.
Let's break it down now into the individual phases. Let's first focus on the approach.
Similar to the long jump, the jumper wants to begin their approach by leaning back momentarily, placing their weight on their back foot, creating potential energy to begin the run. Potential energy is equal to 1/2 mass times gravity times the height.
Within the first 2 to 4 steps, in order to overcome moment of inertia, the jumper wants to come to almost full arm extension in their run to create momentum and also overcome air resistance. Moment of inertia is equal to mass times radius squared, and momentum is equal to mass times velocity.
In the approach, it is important to create maximum horizontal velocity and acceleration. Velocity is defined as displacement over time, and acceleration is defined as velocity over time.
Force of the jumper's arms pumping is equally as important as the force of their feet contacting the ground. Force is equal to the mass times acceleration, so is directly related to the acceleration of the body horizontally and the velocity of the legs vertically coming into contact with the ground.
While running, the jumper's legs should come to almost a 90-degree angle with the quads almost parallel to the ground. Also, while flexed, their foot should almost come to the glutes, continuing to cycle through, landing almost directly on the ground under the center of mass to propel the body forward. Newton's first, second, and third laws are all applicable while running towards the board and at the takeoff.
The jumper should hit the board with their takeoff as close to the front of the board as possible and with their body near a 20-degree angle. At the takeoff, the acceleration created during the run will translate to the force of the body off the board.
Using momentum created from the approach phase, the jumper moves into phase one, also known as the hop part of the jump. The opposite foot from the takeoff foot is pulled with maximum force from trailing behind the body to a 90-degree angle at the knee. The foot cycles through without touching the ground, creating momentum to propel the body forward.
Some key points to remember for this phase are: it is important to pull the leg through at maximum velocity to transfer horizontal velocity and momentum down the runway. In the hop phase, it is more important to create more horizontal than vertical displacement in order to maintain the momentum in the direction desired. And when landing the first phase, the jumper needs to land back on the takeoff foot directly under the body and with slight flexion at the knee to drive the body into the second phase.
Transitioning from the first phase into the second phase consists of leaping off of the same foot that was used in phase one. The second phase is also known as a skip or a bound. Proper form in this phase consists of jumping off the takeoff foot and driving the opposite foot with maximum force.
The jumper should be in running stance with the knee and hip flexed and the thigh parallel to the ground. And also, like in the first phase, it is important not to get too much of a vertical distance because the momentum that is horizontal will be significantly decreased and the total distance will suffer.
The final part of this phase is to land with the opposite foot from the takeoff foot under the body to drive into the third phase. It is important throughout all phases to land with a bent knee so the jumper is able to create force into the next phase. Locking the knee puts a brake on the velocity of the jump and shortens the overall distance.
Starting the third phase, also known as the jump phase, the takeoff leg is extended forcefully upon contact with the ground. The jumper springs up with as much force as possible to gain maximum airtime. For best performance, the jumper's takeoff leg should be under the center of gravity of the body. The center of gravity is defined as the point around which a body's weight is equally balanced in all directions.
While the jumper is in the air in this phase before landing, there are a variety of techniques utilized by different athletes to continue to project themselves, looking to achieve maximum distance. Right before landing, both legs are swung forward to continue the momentum.
At the point of landing again, jumpers have a variety of landing techniques to optimize the jump. As opposed to the first two phases, the jump phase is directed more vertically to allow for as much time in the air as possible.
Keeping the rhythm of the three phases will help maintain the speed and therefore increase the distance. Balance, along with maintaining a straight path, is important to remain tight and reduce air resistance for top speed throughout the jump. Straying away from these two principles will greatly reduce velocity and kinetic energy.
In all three phases, it is important to take advantage of yourself as a projectile and utilize as much hang time as possible. As we previously stated, Newton's three laws are important to remember throughout the whole jump.
The first law states a body will maintain a state of rest or constant velocity unless acted on by an external force that changes the state. The force of the ground changes the state of the jumper.
The second law states that a force applied to a body causes acceleration of that body of magnitude proportional to the force in the direction of the force and inversely proportional to the body's mass. Force is applied continuously throughout the jump, which is always dependent on the mass of the body.
Newton's third law states that every action has an equal and opposite reaction. When one body exerts a force on a second, the second body exerts a reaction that is equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. An example of this is the jumper striking the ground and the ground being propelled in the opposite direction.
And here's some of our Eau Claire athletes training.
Come on.